Hello everybody, Tracking Racing here, checking in, getting another video going. Definitely have some updates on both the cars, and although this wasn't kind of a video that I was expecting to do, it's a video that I'm excited to do because I have the MR2 in a rare position to kind of go over some of the bits of the wide body kit that I have never been able to discuss on the page before. But quickly before getting to there, maybe some IS300 updates, just in case that's what you're looking for. I have done some refreshing. I have to mine the pollen. There's absolutely tons and tons of pollen on the motor. But I have actually finished up the motor. Gosh, even more pollen than I thought there was supposed to be on there. Anyway, I have finished up the motor. Motor is ready to go in. Everything's done. All the accessories are on. Belts on. All the wiring's in place as far as the motor is concerned. Engine is concerned. I did also add in power steering lines. This is a fantastic kit from Finishing Lines. This kit basically relocates the power steering block, or the ABS block, sorry, ABS block, from usually it's over here to over in this position. You don't have to necessarily relocate this for the V8 swap, and I do want to get this out there because I feel like I was almost fibbed to a little bit about having to move that. You can definitely get away with a 1UZ, 3UZ, 2UZ, whatever UZ swap you want inside of an IS300 and not have to relocate the ABS block. It just means you have to do some kind of tricky stuff with your air filter, either possibly run it in front, run it below, run just a pipe, and then run your filter like kind of below that area. There's definitely ways to do it. Also, you don't need a relocation kit to relocate it either. You could use the stock metal lines, cut them, bend them, and re-flare them to go in this location. And that's not very expensive to do either, really. It's a fairly cheap tool, and it's not a bad process. You know, stock metal lines like these guys right there. But I will say that, I was skeptical about spending the money to get these. And then all of a sudden, I got them, and now I'm super happy with it. Finishing Lines does a great job with them. I ended up getting these gold little accents because obviously it'll kind of match the gold or bronze that I have in some locations. It's really nicely ran, keeps them really nice and tidy, looks very good on the master cylinder. So I'm really happy with them. Honestly, now at the end, I do think that it was worth the money to get the Finishing Lines kit. I definitely think that it looks really good. And it'll just mean that I don't have to worry about any leaks or any issues like that. So they also run all the way down to the brake lines, right? All the way down there. Also, something that I did was I relocated the ABS block onto my old battery box location or battery tray. So my battery is relocated to the back. I've got a subwoofer that I'm running, an amp back there, so I figured it'd just be smart. Also opened up this area for me. Also allowed this area to be open specifically so I could move the ABS block into this location, which ended up working quite nice as well. So definitely pretty happy with how this turned out. I would have done a how-to on this, but it's so freaking simple. So if you're gonna do this, it's literally, you just take this bracket off of the car, you find where it mounts to here, and you mount it to there. It's not that difficult. Now, I also mounted my battery cables. I got some kind of like prongs. You can see them down there. Mounted them onto the box so that way I can just mount my positives there, mount my negatives there, and have everything going to one solid location. I've also kind of had to extend this wiring right here to the ABS block off of the main wiring here. A few little updates there. I've been doing some small things here and there. Again, here's power steering from Chase Bays. Not sure if I've covered that before, but it's a nice little piece. Didn't cost too much, mounted really easy to that location. I think I'm also going to put my catch can right there to kind of make things rather slick. So, all in all, not too bad. I've gotten some work done, but I'm waiting for my going with a GS 400. Power steering rack, and what that's going to do is hopefully move over my steering pickup point a little bit, which will give room for those headers just a little bit. So I'm trying to do as much or as little chopping on the headers as I possibly can, and really changing out the steering rack seemed like a smart idea. If you're not aware of that, the power steering rack swaps out no problem between GS's and IS's. Works really, really well, and supposedly moves this over just a little bit. So hopefully it's going to happen. Shout out to Hail Razor's Garage. The Hail people are amazing people, and I've gotten a lot of parts from them for this build because they know GS's quite well and have quite a lot of them. So I can't wait to get that part, put that in, and really that's the only thing stopping the engine from getting in for a secondary test fit, so that way I can figure out what's going on with the exhaust. So once I get the new steering rack, engine goes in, test fit for the exhaust, remake the exhaust, and then pretty much everything's done. Waiting for my wiring harness, and then everything should be able to start up no problem. A few other things you'll notice, I got this TRD bar. Really like that. That's a nice little sexy piece right there. I also ended up getting, not sure if I've talked about it before, but I ended up getting a 10K cluster for the car too, which I'm super excited about. It's not in yet. Oh, there it is right there. 10K cluster, yay! I'll definitely post up some more information about that in the future and wiring and what I'll have to do to make that work. So that's where the IS300 is, or IS430 is currently. That's the big update on that. So waiting for all those kind of smaller pieces, and then I'll be able to put everything in. But right now I'm pretty happy where it sits, other than the fact that it's a little bit dirty, right? So let's get to the MR2, right? We haven't talked too much in specific about the MR2 lately. Been having some steering issues. Some of you are aware of that. I'm not going to go through that now, but basically those issues have given me some time, let's say, to work on some other things to try to get some wins on the board, as I like to say. You know, if you have a problem that keeps on plaguing you and you just can't fix it and it's annoying you and it's starting to cause you stress and it's making your fun project car not so fun anymore, i.e. what was happening to me, what you need to do is focus on other parts, other aspects of the build that you can improve upon, right? So that's what I've done. I've wanted to make some new brackets for my side skirts wide body kit to kind of just help hold things a little bit better and also make it a little bit easier to disassemble and reassemble when needed. Now, I mean, in the 6 years that I've had this on, I've barely assembled and reassembled it, but a lot of that is because the reason it was pretty cumbersome to do, whereas now I want to kind of make it a little bit easier, right? Fix things up and make it easier to pull on and pull off. So one thing is you'll notice in the back that to fit my 10-inch rear wheels, I've had to do a lot of banging. So I'm sure I'll get some questions, comments about that, but that's what all of that stuff is right there. That's just a bunch of banging, me grinding stuff down, and clearancing for those big ol' rear wheels. So let's get to brackets. All right, number one thing. When brackets don't have to hold a lot of weight, I mean, surely there's more structural things than other things to use. Meaning like square tube, round tube, whatever, and, you know, better materials to use like steel versus aluminum, etc. When it comes to just doing bracketry for like a wide body kit or something like that that's not going to receive a lot of force, not holding a lot of weight, you don't have to go that crazy with it. You know, call me out if you want and say that these brackets are crappy, and that's completely fine. But this is all material that I had inside of the garage. Makes it really easy to make brackets out of. So I could have used, you know, an L material. I could have used just bar stock. I could have used square tube. I could have used round tube. I had this channel tubing. I don't know where in the heck I got it from, this channel tubing. I mean, you know, I wouldn't necessarily suggest it if you can just get regular rectangular square tubing. But this is what I had in the shop, so that's what I used. So end result is for these back fenders right here, I needed to find a connection point that would work for the back fender and also for the side skirt. And these side skirts are pretty darn heavy. As much as this kit was made like crap, I mean absolute crap, it makes me happy to see that there's a few companies that are starting to remake it. Hopefully they can do a better job. But as much as this original kit that I got from CLP is crap, these sides are like heavy, thick fiberglass. I am actually impressed with the thickness of the side skirts. So anyway, this does need to hold a good bit. So what I did was is I just made an angled bracket. I attached it here to the pinch weld of the car. The main reason why I did that is because I can't get to the inside of this space very easily, right? So bolting it from the inside would have been very, very difficult. So what I did was is I just grabbed onto the pinch weld, drew the pinch weld out, and that gave me more access to this area right here. So then I just had a little slot in the middle, slotted my tube over the top of it, bolted that in so I can remove it later if I wanted to. You know, if I was had welding skills and stuff like that, maybe I would have welded it, but just bolted it, right? And then trimmed everything else to work, and then used a rivet nut in here to be able to bolt everything too. So this will slip under here, and then all those will stack and bolt up right here. Now, to keep everything directed the proper way, I also have another little panel right here. I just straightened out this bracket, added this little single piece, and then again added another rivet nut on here to make it very easy to bolt on and bolt off, and that attaches down here. So more structural rigidity up here, being able to hold it, everything stacking on top of it, and this can hold a lot of weight. And then I also have it controlled and captured down here to make sure that it's also, you know, supported and can't angle inward against pressures or anything like that. So that's how I did my back brackets. And again, you know, all this is done with just Dremel and simple tools, so it doesn't have to be anything extreme. These bolts, you know, just locking nuts, regular bolts, easy hardware that you can get from wherever. So it doesn't have to be anything crazy. This is just simple bar stock. It was already actually pre-drilled that I think I got from Home Depot. It's a little bit stronger than this aluminum, but either way, simple brackets to do a simple job, right? So this is what I've upgraded my side brackets to. It's gonna be able to hold a lot more weight, keep things straighter. And I've also kind of adjusted things since I originally did this setup. And I've actually been slowly bringing the fenders out a little bit to adapt for the wheels and give me some more space. But let's keep moving around. So up here, I actually added a support. Again, you know, not the most fancy thing in the world, but at the same time, works quite well. So this bracket right here is supporting the inside of the fender, make sure the fender isn't pushing in. Also keeps the fender pushed out to where I need to, and then supports and again gets attached inside of here with those rivet nuts. Those rivet nuts are basically great for absolutely everything. They work for all of your possible needs of attaching anything that you could possibly need, but they also make it so you can detach it super easy as well. If I need to pop these off, I can, it's not an issue. So as we continue to move back here, let me move this leg around. So I do want to talk about these supports. I want to show you the supports that I have, but I also want to talk to you about Professional Awesome Racing, which is a new sponsor that I have. I'm going to replace most of these supports with the supports that Professional Awesome Racing makes, because they're just, I mean, they're awesome. They're great supports. These are kind of, you know, simple supports that I was able to make at, you know, with Home Depot parts fairly easily. But at the same time, I want a more professional setup and something that's a little bit more easily adjustable and something that also makes me feel a little bit better about the overall functionality of it. So right now, this is what I'm working with. I basically took threaded rod, used a turnbuckle style center support, and then put a locking nut on it. On the bottom, I'm using all pull pins. So these little pull pins make it really easy to pull that pin out and then basically just start to drop all of the diffuser. So all of the diffuser is attached in the same way. Even these back supports right here are attached with those same pins. So I pull all four pins out of the top and then I pull two pins out here on the bottom and then everything pops right out. So that's a little tip. You know, if you're looking for a budget way of getting these supports made or just looking for something superficial to get started, you can definitely make some stuff out of Home Depot's hardware section and do quite well with it. And you can also use Amazon as a resource, which is what I did for these turnbuckles right here. But again, I'm really looking forward to replacing all of this hardware with some professional stuff that I know can trust on the track and utilize and beat up and feel much more secure in it, which is what Professional Awesome Stuff is definitely going to do. So soon I'll be placing my order with them and getting in a whole bunch of new goodies and getting everything replaced on here that needs to be replaced. But as you can see, everything is adjustable. Alright, so I can adjust the angle of the diffuser. I can also adjust its forward back movement as well. And again, I just pull some pins and everything drops right to the floor. Super, super quick. I can also do a lanyard system where I wrap a lanyard through all of the different pins, and I could literally pull all of the pins if facing the same direction at the same time by pulling that lanyard. So my supports in the back, my supports for the fender, and my supports for the diffuser. That covers all of that. So let's go up front then. So up front, I actually just changed some things. If you follow my Instagram, you may have seen that I've actually changed this support right here. So this support was just a bar stock originally, and it was actually not even facing the correct direction, which means like the bar stock was facing upward, which means it would be blocking air or causing drag. And even though, I mean, minuscule amounts, it's not what you want. So now I've got this nice flat panel here, which is gonna allow air to hit it in direct, which is what you want, right? You want it to split the air. But this will also act as not only a mounting surface for the fender to the body, but it's also gonna act as a mounting surface for some panels that I'm gonna install here that'll attach to the side skirt that'll allow for more air ducting, better drawing of the air out of the fender space, and more diverting of the air and creating of vortices down the side of the body, which is obviously good stuff for aerodynamics sake. So the thought process here is that now that this is nice and flat, it'll be diverting air, and then I'll have those air panels, which will make sure to divert air away from this pocket, so it actually doesn't get inside of the door. It diverts past the door, and then also helps kind of divide the air out and create some vortices going down the side of the car. I'm considering trimming off the top of this and actually just having that panel continue all the way down to the bottom of this. But we'll definitely, I'll have some more updates about that in the future and kind of show you guys that process and how I make that. Again, here's more rivet nuts up front. These rivet nuts attached to the side fender just right there. So rivet nuts everywhere on this. It's the best way to go. You get yourself a little rivet nut gun, you get a whole bunch of rivet nuts from Amazon, and then boom, you can affix anything to a sheet metal surface. And makes it really easy to just bolt, screw things right in and get them right on the car. So that's the front fender. So as far as the splitter goes, there are lots of mounts that I have for the splitter. And again, these are some of the mounts that are going to get replaced by Professional Awesome mounts. These are just some cheapo mounts that I had found somewhere online. They've worked for the time being. I've got some structured up here to be able to support where the fender meets the front bumper. And then I also have an independent one down here that's supporting the splitter. Now that's not all I have supporting the splitter. I also have a frame up here, if you can see. And that frame is attached to two large arms that also act as air diverters to the radiator. So this air diverter right here is actually attached to both sides. Again, rivet nuts on the bottom, and allows me to have some structural rigidity to the splitter. It takes a lot of weight, but also having that air direct into the radiator, which is also what this bottom flap is doing, directing air up into the radiator. So, you know, tons of support, takes tons of weight, but again, I'm excited about getting Professional Awesome Racing's parts in because they have a quick disconnect for the front splitter. So as you can tell, my splitter is currently not quick disconnect, even though the rear diffuser is, and most of the other parts are. So it'd be really, really nice to be able to get their front quick disconnect. They've got like a little pull pin system where the whole thing will drop right down. And I think that's just going to be absolutely awesome for this car. So, you know, with that, some of their splitter rods and some of their additional pieces, they also have a cool flap system for the splitter that allows the air to kind of come up into the in to meet the wheel much better. So a lot of those things I'm going to be very excited to get and upgrade my setup with. But you know, I figured people really love bracket work. You know, I'm not sure why. I'm not even trying to be like that, but I see YouTube videos all the time where they're showing, you know, 30 minutes of someone making like this really simple bracket in slow motion, and I'm like, why do people want to see this stuff? But I get it, I get it. Sometimes that's the hard stuff to think about, is how to make these brackets, what to make them out of. A lot of times threaded rod, turnbuckles, you get some square tubing, some circle tubing, even some channel tubing, even some bar stock, simple bar stock with some holes in it. It doesn't have to be fancy to start off with. it needs to be functional, right? So you just need to make sure that it's rigid enough and it'll work for what you need. And then lastly, again, the secret to all of this, in my personal opinion, are these rivet nuts. Let's see, where's my little rivet nut thing? Here it is. This is just some of them. I've got tons of these. Tons of these boxes of rivet nuts, all different size, right? The tool is exactly the same as a standard riveter, right? There's a normal riveter, and here's a rivet nut gun. They're nearly identical. Cost super, it's super, super cheap on Amazon, and you don't have to buy Amazon stuff. You can buy other stuff, but again, if you wanna just get it started, that's an easy way to do it. So, there's all the brackets on the MR2, what they do, kinda how I made them, that sort of thing, without doing some sort of weird slow motion video showing you every little cut that I do. But I simply use a Dremel or a simple die grinder. Boom, Harbor Freight, right? There's the die grinder right there. My Dremel's already put up. So those are the easy ways of being able to make brackets and just make something that works. Utilize the rivet nut to be able to make it easy attach. You know, put your bolts on the outside and make sure they're streamlined to the bottom of the car so you don't catch anything on the road. But then all of a sudden it makes it super easy. You're just unbolting everything like it's an OEM part on the car, an OEM fender on the car. And that's really what you want, right? You want the OEM accessibility and ease of use, but with that higher functionality of having a wide body kit. So, you know, a lot of people get these body kits and they expect them to just pop right on, you know, just like they should, and then realize that they got to even screw the holes in the fiberglass. It's a lot of work to get these wide body kits on, and you're going to have to do some interesting bracketry to be able to do so. Don't get too caught up on it, but at the same time, make sure that you're doing enough because you don't want this stuff to tear off on the road. I'll be honest in saying that the simple brackets that I had before updating the stuff that I did down here and up front, I'm very surprised that they lasted the 5 or 6 years that they did. I'm glad that I'm upgrading them now and spending the time to do this, and I definitely think it's well worth it. So there's the bracket rundown on the MR2. If you have any specific questions, you know, especially if you're running one of these wide bodies and want to know way more in detail about this stuff, I'll be glad to give it to you. Any knowledge that I have is knowledge that I hope and expect to share. But hopefully that gives you just a basic rundown. Maybe if you're doing any project car and want to start making some brackets, get you some square tube, rectangle tube at different thicknesses, material grades, right? Get you some bar stock at different widths and lengths and some sheet metal stock and you're good to go. Die grinder and you can start rocking it and it's pretty, pretty easy, right? So, hope everyone enjoyed this video. Hope everyone's having a good time. Enjoy your project cars, get out there and work on them, and when something gets frustrated, don't get stuck on that part. Move to something else, put your time and effort and thought into something that can be better used instead of just getting tripped over one thing, like I was, because that's what happened to me. So don't let it happen to you. Get to work on other things, keep working on it, keep moving forward.